Matthew chapter 14, starting with verse 25. Matei, capitolul 14, cu versetul 25. Unde cuvântul Domnului spune așa. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came to them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It's a ghost." But they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter said to him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. Până aici cuvântul Domnului. Vă invit să reocupați locurile. Vreau și eu să spun un bun venit la frații care ne vizitează. Domnul să vă binecuvânteze. Frații vor cânta, ori vor avea o cântare și vom avea părtășie minunată împreună. Have you noticed that God usually does not show up when we expect him to show up? Have you noticed that when he does show up, that he doesn't show up how we expect him to show up? I mean, I can think of multiple examples in my own life, and if you really think about it in your own life, he usually does not show up when we expect him to show up, and when he does show up, he doesn't come how we expect him to show. And if we're unaware of this fact, it usually leads to disappointment in the life of a sincere Christian. They tend to be disappointed. "Jesus, you didn't show up. Or you didn't show up how I expected you to." Do you know that the disciples in this case that had been rowing all night didn't expect for Jesus to come in the morning? I mean, I'm assuming that they expected him to show up after an hour or two on the sea. When it started getting hard, when the wind picked up, when the waves were high, I'm assuming they're like, "Okay, Jesus, where are you? This would be a good time for you to show up." He showed up in the morning. And then they certainly didn't expect him to come walking on the water. I'm assuming they expected to, they always look back to see another boat showing up. And they kept on looking back. No boat, no Jesus. There are certain opportunities that we have with God that will only show up once or twice in our entire lifetime. And we can't afford to miss those moments. We cannot afford to miss those moments because of ignorance. Because we don't know when or how God does things, because we put him in a box. We can't afford to miss those moments because of our own misplaced focus, where we focus on something else rather than focusing on him. We can't afford to miss those moments because we have a lack of reverence for him and for his things, and thus we miss him completely. The title of my message tonight is Recognizing the Moment of Your Visitation. Recognizing the Moment of Your Visitation. I pray that this word tonight would sensitize us, to cause us to just become so zealous for God and for those moments that none of us would miss them. It would be a tragedy to know that God had something absolutely fantastic, something special for you, and you completely missed it. That you didn't take advantage of it. I certainly don't want to miss out. I don't think any of us do. So if we want to benefit from the special moments of God's visitation, we must first recognize God's presence. That's my first point in this message. We must first recognize God's presence. When Jesus did eventually come in the morning, do you know that the disciples, they didn't recognize who he was. They thought he was a ghost. They did not expect him coming on the water. The two disciples after the resurrection that were walking on their way to Emmaus, they didn't recognize Jesus. They walked with him a long distance, had no clue. And after the resurrection, when they went fishing, and didn't catch anything all night. When Jesus was on the shore, again, they did not recognize him. Notice a trend. People not recognizing Jesus. In each case, in each one of those cases, there is a real risk that Jesus would have passed them by. That Jesus was present, and yes, they could have completely missed out on all of that. And the reality is that for each one of us and for our church, for Emmanuel, there's a real risk that Jesus can come where we don't recognize him and he passes right on by. If I look in my own life, and I am certain if you look in your own life, some of the most consequential encounters with God came in the most unassuming and random appearing encounters. I mean, impacts and encounters with God that completely changed the course of my life. If I would have known, I would have certainly prepared. Do you know that that's how usually Jesus comes? Most of the time, we don't expect him to come. We don't have our antennas up. Jesus is not always easily recognized, contrary to popular belief. And the scripture points that out. And we think, you know, surely if Jesus would come in my life and there was an, I would know about it. No, you would not. The disciples who spent 3.5 years with him didn't recognize him. He doesn't show up in the form that we expect most of the time. I mean, as Jesus was coming towards them, they thought it was a ghost. The two disciples walking with him on the way to Emmaus, they said, "Are you the only stranger?" They thought he was a stranger. These are disciples of Jesus. What is the common denominator of people missing Jesus, of not recognizing him? I look through the scripture and all of those encounters. You know what the common denominator is? Disappointment. Disappointment with God. And this is a common denominator for us. Do you know that disappointment with God in our own lives casts a shadow over our eyes where it becomes much harder for us to recognize Jesus? Well, disappointment, first of all, robs you of your faith. And more than that, it robs you of your hope. And hope is really a confident expectation of good. Interestingly, as we look at those scriptures, our biggest disappointments in life are God's most spectacular appointments with us. Our biggest disappointments are God's most spectacular appointments. Notice the disciples had been working hard all night. I mean, they toiled all night rowing that boat against the wind. What were they just full of in the morning? Disappointment. They're disappointed that Jesus didn't show up. When they fished all night and didn't catch anything, what did they have in the morning? Disappointment. No success. The two on the road to Emmaus, what were they? What was covering their eyes and their heart? Disappointment. And you could hear it from what they're saying. We thought he was. We thought he was going to be the one to deliver Israel, but you know, that didn't happen. Disappointment. God will often come to visit us at the very end of our disappointment. I've seen it in my life where I'm like, okay, this thing is dead. There's no chance of anything happening. And God shows up. And I think that God wants to just kind of grab us and say, don't let the enemy rob you of the encounter that God has planned for you. God will often come to visit us at the very end of our greatest disappointments, when we least expect him to show up. And I pray that God would sensitize our hearts, that when he does show up, that we would all recognize him, that we would say, that's Jesus. Just like John, he was the only one in the boat after they had been fishing all night. They said, that's the Lord. There was one that recognized him. And I pray that we would be sensitized in the same way, that when Jesus shows up, deep in our hearts, something would say, that's the Lord. And we can benefit from that encounter. Secondly, we have a responsibility to steward the moments of God's visitation. We have a responsibility to steward the moments of God's visitation. When God shows up, we're partly responsible. I want you guys to notice something. The 12 disciples, they all had only one opportunity to walk on water. They would never get another chance. Never. There was one moment, and they had to steward that moment well. The disciples didn't know that it was a unique moment. They didn't know how to steward that special presence. There are times when Jesus shows up, when God shows up for a very specific purpose, and they didn't know how to take advantage of it. And the tragedy is that this unique opportunity passed them by. Out of the 12, only Peter took advantage of that opportunity. I don't think any of us want to be in the position of the other 11 disciples. We're like, we could have benefited from the same thing. God showed up and we didn't take advantage of it. We didn't recognize him. We didn't act. We didn't know how to steward that special moment. It's a tragedy when we get so accustomed to religious services, to coming to church, to doing things, to singing, to praying, and to lose that sensitivity to know when the Spirit is moving in a very specific and unique way. I really tremble at the current nonchalance of the modern church today, the way they treat church services. There's a really kind of a chorus, come as you are. Well, sure, you come as you are, but you leave transformed and changed. You don't stay the same. And people are content. God is love. I can just live my life. They become so dull that they don't sense the Spirit moving, the Spirit knocking at the door of their heart. I mean, I certainly don't want anything in my heart, anything to cause me to miss on a special visitation. Here's what it says in Luke chapter 5, verses 17. Talking about a special occasion where Jesus showed up, where the power of God was there for a specific purpose. Luke chapter 5, verse 17. One day, it didn't say every day. One day, Jesus was teaching, and there were some Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting there, nonchalance, who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and from Jerusalem. And notice, and the power of the Lord was present, notice, for him, for Jesus to perform healing. There was a special moment where the power of the Lord was there with a specific purpose, in a greater way to affect, to bless people with healing. Do you realize that this has happened in church history at Azusa Street, right here in Southern California, where the power of God would come down for a specific purpose? One night, all the deaf people would be healed. Another night, all the lame people would be healed. Another night, people would be delivered of habitual sin and things like that. I remember one of the healing evangelists of the 50s saying that as he was doing healing revivals, there would be moments where he would sense the physical presence of God coming upon him. And he said it would last about 30 to 40 seconds. And he would run as fast as possible to touch as many people that were sick in the audience. And he said not once was there one individual that was touched, not healed. And he said, I couldn't produce that. What was happening? The power of the Lord was present with a specific purpose, to perform healing for a divine purpose. Do you know that God arranges specific moments in our lives like that? God was there that day for the disciples to walk on water. That was the specific purpose. They missed it. Notice the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. They were there. I am sure they had sicknesses as well. Completely missed it. The special power of God was there with a divine purpose to heal. You know, there are times when God in his sovereignty shows up in our lives and shows up in our church here at Emmanuel for a specific purpose that is unbeknownst to us. And we cannot afford to miss those opportunities. Notice in Luke chapter 19 with verse 41, another special visitation of the Lord where the people completely missed it. And I'm sure they thought, we're the children of Abraham. We know the law. We would never miss God when he would show up. Well, he did show up and they completely missed it. Luke chapter 19 with verse 41, it says, when Jesus approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and wept over it. Why did he weep? Because he was there to bless them and they completely missed it. Notice what Jesus said. If you had known this day, if you would have known what is available to you today, if you would have known this day, even you, the things which make for peace. But notice, but now they have been hidden from your eyes. You know what he's saying here? It's like you're in a gate at the airport, and there's an announcement that keeps saying, boarding in progress, boarding in progress, and you're just insensitive. And you wake up when the door is already closed. There's no way of getting back in. And this is what Jesus is saying. He had sent the prophets, John the Baptist, repent. He had been preaching for 3.5 years. They completely missed it. And he's saying, it's too late now. But now they have been hidden from your eyes, for the days will come upon you when your enemies will throw up a barricade against you and surround you and hem you in on every side, and they will level you to the ground and your children within you, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another. Why? Because you did not recognize the time of your visitation. Can you fathom the fact that he came to visit them, to protect them from all of those things? Do you know that God has special moments like that in our lives, for our church? And if we don't have a heart to say, Lord, I do not want to miss it. Lord, whatever it takes, sensitize my heart. Lord, I want to know when you're moving, I want to know. Because you know what? The enemy will keep you busy. For your heart to be affected, for you to completely miss it. If you value something, you go to great lengths to protect it. If you have a box of diamonds or a collection of gold coins that is worth a lot of money, you do not leave that around the yard. I mean, you watch over that thing. You protect that thing. That thing is valuable to you. But if you have a rusty old bicycle, I don't think you bring that inside. And the question that the Holy Spirit would ask us tonight, how much do we treasure the presence of the Holy Spirit? How much do we long for Jesus and for those moments? The parents of John the Baptist, it's saying that they were looking forward. They were waiting for the Messiah. They were treasuring that moment and they didn't miss it. Anna, the prophetess, and other people, they were praying for the deliverance of Israel. They didn't miss it. They noticed Jesus, but the majority of Israel completely missed it. You know, I'm sorry to say, but a lot of what the modern church calls the presence of the Lord is nothing more than the excitement of the flesh. There's no difference between having a concert with great music and going to a theatrical appearance where it stimulates the flesh. And we advertising, this is the presence of the Lord. So much of what is attributed to the Spirit is really just the fruit of the flesh. And the sad part is that this is false advertising. And when people come and they come to church and they expect to encounter Jesus, and they're like, well, I can get this in the world. I don't need this from the church. They don't encounter Jesus or the presence of God because it's false advertising. It says in Romans chapter 2 with verse 23, "You who boast in the law through your breaking of the law, do you dishonor God? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you." God forbid should that happen to us. We have a responsibility to steward the presence of God. We need to be really honest and to say, you know what, we don't want to have any false advertising. Lord, we will not stop until we have your presence and your presence alone. And we will treasure that. Thirdly, third point, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. If you don't want to miss God's special appointment for you, for your family, for our church, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Here's what it says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." And then it gives two lists, one negative and one positive. He's saying, if you do these negative things, you grieve the Holy Spirit and he departs. If you do these things, the positive things, that welcomes the Holy Spirit, that draws him in. And first, it gives the negative list. It says, "Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice." Ephesians chapter 4 with verse 30. This is the negative list. Let all bitterness. It doesn't say let some bitterness. It says let all bitterness. Bitterness is resentment. It's indignation for being treated unfairly, in our opinion. And he is saying, the word is saying, let all bitterness be put away. Why? It grieves the Holy Spirit. Let all wrath. Wrath is a strong feeling of anger, of rage. And he's saying, let all wrath be put away. And clamor. This is quarreling. This is uproar. This is the gossip that's going on in church, talking about what so-and-so did what. It's saying, let all clamor be put away. All slander. Slander is spreading untrue or derogatory statements about someone to hurt their reputation. He's saying the Holy Spirit is grieved when that's going on in his church. And yet, there's Christians who have bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, slander, malice, desire to harm someone, and claim, "I'm a child of God. I hear from God. I have prophetic words." But it says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. When you have those things in your life, you are not hearing from the Holy Spirit. I can tell you that based on Scripture. Well, how do you welcome? What's the positive list? How do you encourage the Holy Spirit? How do you welcome him? The positive list. Be kind to one another. Tender-hearted. Having a soft heart for your brother and sister in church. Forgiving each other. Well, Lord, how do you expect us to forgive each other? Just as God in Christ also has forgiven you. Let me ask you, how did God forgive you? Is he mentioning the things that you did in your past? No, he says he threw it in the sea of forgetfulness. I mean, God, once you ask for forgiveness, he just does away with that thing. And God is saying here, if we want the move of the Holy Spirit in our families, in our lives, in our church, we need to be kind with one another. We need to be tender-hearted, forgiving one another. Just as God in Christ has forgiven me, not less, exactly as. Because grieving the Spirit will lead us into error. We think we're hearing from God, and we're not. It's our imagination, or worse, an evil spirit. Because God will not be mocked. He does not say something in his word and do something else in practice. There's so many things that we do that grieve the Spirit. Anytime we try to do spiritual things in the flesh, anytime we try to do ministry in the flesh and not in the order that he gave in Scripture, anytime we do anything that is not under the direction and anointing of the Spirit, here's what Jesus says in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, "But you will first receive power when the Holy Spirit will come upon you." That's the first thing. You're full of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. Then you move into ministry. Then you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria. There's an order. And any disobedience, subtle or outright, will grieve the Spirit of God. I was once at a Pentecostal conference where I was expecting to encounter God. Many pastors. And I was so disappointed when I saw that instead of the anointing, there's a lot of activities, a lot of things going on, but not the anointing of God. And a well-known pastor, if I would tell you his name, turned towards me. And he said, "These effects, what you see here, are nothing else than the shields of bronze." And I knew what he was referring to. There was smoke on the stage, there were huge screen, lights everywhere, really loud. People were pretending, you know, like God is present, but my goodness, no, he was not. Any just reasonable Christian would know that. But in 1 Kings chapter 14 with verse 25, it said, "Now it happened in the fifth year of King Rehoboam that Shishak, the king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem." And notice, he took away the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house, and he took everything, even taking the shields of gold which Solomon had made. So King Rehoboam made shields of bronze in their place. The enemy came and took away the treasures of the house of the Lord. What's the purpose of the enemy when he comes to Emmanuel Church? To take away the treasures of the house of God. How do people respond? Denial. You know what? We don't have the shields of gold. So we'll make shields of bronze in their place. The presence of God is no longer here. Well, let's act like it is. You know, the anointing is not on the preaching like it used to. And when the anointing comes, man, the volume goes up and you're excited with the anointing of the Lord. So the anointing is not here, so we just bump up the volume. But something's missing, the anointing. You know, when the presence of God we sing, man, we are loud. We enjoy the presence of God. You know, the presence of God is no longer there. The enemy took away the treasures of the house of the Lord, which is the presence of the Spirit. So we just bump up the volume. And we can do that with absolutely every activity in church. The sad part is that the shields of bronze looked exactly like the shields of gold to the untrained eye, to somebody that didn't have the sensitivity. And the same thing is happening to the untrained eye. You'd say, "Oh, that church is alive." Really? Fig leaves could not cover Adam's nakedness. An eloquent sermon with impressive terminology can never replace the anointing of the Spirit. Music with perfect pitch and harmony can never replace the anointing. Stage lights and fog can never replace the Shekinah glory. Never. Once you've experienced the Shekinah glory, nothing else will do. Once you experience the anointing, nothing else will do. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 18 with verse 6, "But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it would be better for him to have a heavy millstone hung around his neck and be drowned into the depth of the sea." I hope you're hearing my heart tonight. But my job as pastor, along with the other pastors that are here, our job is to be sensitive to the move of the Spirit and to steward that well in this house. I don't want to miss it. I don't. God is calling us to be faithful. Husbands, in your own home, you're the priest of the home. In your home, you're called to be sensitive to the move of the Spirit and to steward that presence faithfully. We must correct anything that grieves the presence of the Spirit. Here's what it says in Ezekiel chapter 3 with verse 17. "Son of man, I have appointed you a watchman to the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, warn them from me. A watchman has one responsibility, to be on the lookout for God and to warn. Every husband has that responsibility in their family. Every pastor in this church has this responsibility. And notice, this is not a job that anyone can pick. No, no, this is by appointment only. Son of man, I have appointed you. There's a specific order in God's house. Grace goes with the chair. When God made you a husband in your home, he gave you the grace to hear from God. If you're abdicating that responsibility, that's your problem. God has anointed the pastors of this house to hear from the Lord. And if they abdicate their responsibility, we will be judged by God. Gifting, ability, sensitivity, anointing, everything. God just gives the grace that is necessary to the pastors and the husbands. And we cannot abandon our responsibility. And our job is when we sense a move of the Spirit, this is the positive sense, God is here to steward that presence. And when we're worshiping or we're doing something and we get a check in our heart from the Spirit that something is grieving the Spirit, we're supposed to act. We're appointed as watchmen. This is a responsibility that was given to us by God. You see, God usually does not show up when or how we expect him to. We can't afford to miss those moments because of spiritual abdication, because we're not at the place where God calls us as pastors and husbands, because of ignorance, because of misplaced focus, because of a lack of proper reverence for the things of God. And I pray that no family in this church will miss the hour of their visitation. I pray that in our church, we would not miss the hour of our visitation. I pray that we would all walk on water and experience the miraculous, the blessing of God that he has appointed for us. Amen.